school committee meeting to order. Before we start, do I have a motion?
On school choice?
Yeah.
Mr. Chair, move pursuant to the provisions of GLC 76 and 12B that the school committee of Reading, following a public hearing, hereby withdraws from its obligation to enroll non-resident students in Reading Public Schools during the 2016-2017 school year for the following reason: general district enrollment.
Is there a second?
A second.
Dr. Dougherty?
This is an annual vote that you have to take as a school committee, as required by law on school choice. As you know, we've had numerous discussions over this year and in previous years about enrollment and space. You can, under the law, choose to do school choice by level, but I don't even see in our current enrollment information the ability to do it at one particular level. So I would recommend to the committee that you vote against moving forward with school choice for the 16-17 school year.
Any questions, comments?
Nope.
No.
Hearing none, we'll vote on the motion. All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you. So tonight, we'll open up with our presentation from the Reading High School robotics team. But before that, I'd like to know whether there's any public input for anything that's not on the agenda tonight. Seeing none, we'll have the presentation. So you want to introduce it, John?
Sure, I would love to. I'd like to introduce to you our Reading Robotics team. They have come to the committee before and presented, and I know they want to update you on all the exciting things that have been happening this year, both at the local level, but also at the national level and the world level, because they just came back recently from the Worlds at St. Louis. So I'm going to turn it over to the Rockets.
So as you already heard from Dr. Dougherty's gracious introduction from us, we are the RMHS robotics team, the Rockets, Team 4761. My name is Tim Fitzgerald, and I'm a senior this year.
My name is Claire, and I'm also a senior.
My name is Akshita, and I'm a junior.
My name is Tiana, and I'm a freshman.
And we'll have a short presentation about what we've done this year and where we're going in the future.
Our mission is to promote STEM education, and we also do various outreach programs. We pair up with the Burlington team, the DevilBots, and they came to our workshop and we went to theirs for a couple days, and it gains life skills that we can use in our careers after high school, and it helps with the connection between the mentor and the students to gain skills that we can use later in life.
So just a quick refresher. First is a varsity sport for the mind, in which teams worldwide design, build, and compete with their own robots. And first, you'll be hearing more about the first competition and our team in the future slides. So our team was founded in 2012, and we started off as a very small team in a small workplace. However, we were able to overcome that challenge. And in 2013, we were the Boston Rookie All-Stars. And last year, we actually developed a business plan that was awarded. And thanks to you guys and for giving us such a big workspace, we have been able to develop as a team. So this year we've really improved on our team structure. And we've streamlined many of our team leads in order to organize our team further. So we have cut down on a few leads while also expanding many of the domains. And we've also added many new team leads, like the awards lead, which is held by Claire this year. And what Claire does is she organizes many applications for the many awards we apply for, like, chairmans, which you'll hear about in our future slides as well. However, we do have difficulty trying to get kids to join on the business side of the team. So if you do have any ideas that could help us solve this problem, that would be great.
So the 2016 competition this year was called First Stronghold. And we were sent on a quest to build a bot that can capture a castle. And this was not an easy task for us, for we had many formidable defenses, as you can see in the small picture over there, that we had to cross. And so basically there are a bunch of defenses that we have to cross, and each one of them has a different challenge over it. Some you need a really sturdy drivetrain to go over, otherwise you won't get across. Others you actually have to lift up or open through like a door. And after you do those, you have to actually shoot balls into a tower of sorts, and you eventually capture the tower, and that's the game in a nutshell. And so this year, our robot, its name was Momentum, which we're if we're keeping with the P name, Momentum actually has its math name as a P, so technically counts. But this year we designed an offensive robot with a robust defense to get over those tough obstacles, to go right across without any issue. And we went to shoot in the tower as well, so it would capture the tower, not on its own, but with the help of our teammates, we would capture the tower and score points, and it was really nice. And the drivetrain was a really great design this year, because we actually milled it on our machine, which we were actually able to use because of this bigger space that you guys gave us. And also, it allowed us a lot more designs to cross those defense and made it much more of a process for us to customize.
Okay, so this year we went to four different competitions. The North Shore District event, which was held here in Reading, some of you might have come, is awesome. We hosted for the second year this year. And at that competition, we won the Chairman's Award, which has been a large focus for us this year. And it was awesome to win that award there, and it really pushed us to keep going throughout the season, especially on the business side. On the robot side, we came in fourth out of 40 teams, which was great. And it pushed us to go on into the semifinals in the second competition that we were in Rhode Island. There, we also won the Creativity Award, which was for our vision system on our robot. That was cool to win a tech award, as well as having won the Chairman's Award in a past competition. That allowed us to, the North Shore District event allowed us to go to Hartford, where we also went on to win the Chairman's Award, which allowed us to go to Worlds, which was in St. Louis, and that was really exciting. Of course, we're a younger team, so we didn't have a lot of, chance of winning a lot of awards there, but we went for the experience, and it was awesome to get to know what a huge competition like that would be like. So the Chairman's Award is an award that's composed of three elements, which is a video that we comprised basically just to show what our team is about and who we are. The essay and questions were also to expand on what we are and what we do. And they answered specific questions like, what events have you hosted? What do you do for outreach in the community? And it also asked about our structure of the team so that the judges could really get an in-depth explanation of what we are. And then we also did a presentation at each of those competitions where we showed the judges through a creative way what our team is, so that we could really help them understand the personality of our team and what we do. So through those things, we won the award three times. So in the community this year, besides competitions in the robot, we have collaborated with other teams a lot, more than in other years, and this is pretty cool because FIRST is really about getting involved with your community within your town community, your school community, and within the FIRST community. So we teamed up with other robotics teams in the area like Burlington and Melrose and Billerica, and we shared areas and tools. And going along with the town community, we hosted the Science Expo this year, which some of you might have attended. It basically brought young students into an area with science and experiments where they could immerse themselves in basic experiments to just get them excited about STEM topics. They also presented some of their own experiments, which was very cool to see more than 50 kids really excited about what they'd done. We also had teams and our team demonstrating robots so that those students could see what we do.
This is the district-wide science expo, which we had also had Burlington come over, and they really helped us out in hosting this event. And as Claire said earlier, we had all the kids present their cool things and had them take a look at what we do, and we had the Coolidge Science team also do a short presentation on what they do. And so the kids really were able to see where their STEM future would be if they had chosen to pursue it. So they could go from the Coolidge Science team, if they're there, or the Parker one, because I believe there's one there now. And then they could either come to us or continue with the science team. And so you may be wondering, after such an exciting year for us, what else can we do for the community? Well, we are going to be competing in the off-season events, so we're going to continue to compete in events with this current game, which are hosted by other teams already. So we've gone to a few of those before, one of them being one hosted at Northeastern by Team 125, the Neutrons. It's called Beantown Blitz. And we're going to put back together our t-shirt shooter, because we had to take apart part of that for parts for building our nice drivetrain this year. And so we're going to put that back together and hopefully we'll be able to show that off in the future. And in the spring, we've got coming up in a few days, Teen Tech Week on May 11th, which is really us going to the library. And actually, I think it's hosted here at the Reading Library this year, so it's hosted. And we communicate with the younger kids, and have it's another way for us to show STEM opportunities in the community. And then in the fall, we have the Reading Street Fair. We're going to train some new members, because they always need training, because that six-week crunch is really a tough part. And if they have some idea of what they're doing, it makes it all the easier for us. And we're going to reach out to the Girl Scouts so that we get more girls on our team, because while we have a great showing here, it's not necessarily the most, and we want to continue growing that venue. And we're also going to reach out to the middle school to see if younger kids want to have an opportunity to join our team.
I just want to say that if anyone wants to come to the library workshop, it's on Wednesday, like Tim said, so we're all invited.
And one of the real challenges that we have with as our team is the communication between our business team and our mechanical team, because the business team needs a lot of computers, so they usually work up in the CAD lab, which is about three floors up. And while we're right next door building our robot, it's kind of hard to run up three flights of stairs and ask what's going on there. So we really are looking for some help on how to improve our communication between those two sides. So if you guys have any suggestions, we would be open to hear them, because that is one of the biggest challenges we've had this year. Any questions?
That's great. Thank you. Questions before we open it up. The Devil Bots thing is great. Is that new this year, where you've collaborated with? So do you also compete against them when it, that's
yeah.
Interesting.
It's, so basically they're another team that's really close by, as well as Melrose. And First sees it as a giant community. And while we do compete against each other, we really like to help each other out. So say one of their parts breaks, it won't just be them working on it to get it fixed and us benefiting from it. We'll actually go over and help them if it's during a competition, if we can. So it's really a giant community that reaches out and helps each other, doesn't profit off the misfortune of others.
Now, how do they do in the competitions?
They did not as well as in previous years. So last year, they actually went to Worlds themselves. So they're a good team as well. And this year, they went to district championships in Hartford with us. So that would be like a national event.
So to your question about the business, now is it Mr. Strout? Is he here?
He's over in the shop right now.
He's in the shop.
I don't know whether there could be some. I guess I'm asking you, John, some collaboration with the business department, or some of the business teachers, whether they could work something out with to get those kids to get involved more?
So your challenge is the physical location, right?
Or getting people to help.
Getting people to help, because we have a small business team this year. And like Claire, she's a senior this year, so we have a few seniors that are leaving, and they're going to leave big shoes to fill, so we would also like to have some more people help out this year, as well as communication between our shop here and Three Floors Up. So it's both.
And just one other thing. I understand offense and defense, but the comments you made about your offense, can you give it, I think that's what you were describing when with, can you talk about something from a defensive standpoint?
So basically, if you were a defense robot, you would just smash into other robots and try to keep them from shooting goals or crossing defenses or picking up balls. We played that some of the time, like if our robot was struggling shooting, then we would just keep other robots from shooting.
And do you get points for that or just offense?
It's
you keep other people from getting points.
Which in turn helps us win.
Yes.
I just, on the communication between the two groups, I'm sure you've already thought of this, but like Skype, FaceTime, iPads, are you doing?
That could work. We could connect the two rooms by having them FaceTime.
Yeah, maybe just a couple of iPads would help.
I guess I was thinking the same thing, because of course probably many people here work for global companies, and so we rely on that kind of technology. And but it's pretty handy because every conference room has a big screen TV in it, so that, or more than one, so that you can have documents, people. So you know, depending upon what the specific communication needs are, right, from the business team to the mechanical team or electrical team that's working in the lab, you know, one of the other things that would facilitate that is a larger screen that you can connect any device to and then be able to communicate, you know, across the three floors. I know it sounds, maybe it sounds like it's oversimplified, like, you know, it's only three floors, but you might as well be down the street, because you know, you really need to sort of be able to communicate immediately.
We also have problems with the, so we talked about the business teams versus the technical. But on the technical side, we also have the electrical, the programmers up on, what floor, fourth floor?
They just
guys.
Leave.
So, you know, they talk about the business versus the technical. The technical team itself is also scattered throughout the school most nights that we're here.
Thank you. I wanted to give you some positive feedback on the Science Expo. I did go this year, and it was a fantastic event. It was phenomenal. So thank you for the work that you put into it on top of all the other things you're doing. It was great. I know of at least one elementary school student in town who left saying, can I do a presentation next year? That's great. Like, just what you want. So it was very inspiring for the people, the parents, and the kids who attended. I did have a thought on the business side on recruiting. You may have already thought of this, but work with the guidance office. So when an incoming eighth grader says, I think I want to pursue business, this is a great opportunity that will really enhance your resume for colleges 4 years later. So maybe chat with the guidance folks about when a kid expresses that interest, highlight this as an extracurricular that could really prepare them to stand out among applicants for business schools. And my question for you, those are my two feedback. My question was, having been to Worlds, what lessons did you take back that you're going to bring into the next season? So what did you come back and say, boy, next year we really have to? Like, what were the lessons learned?
So from a technical standpoint, we're going to do a presentation later on all the different bots and different features that we saw happen this year and see how we can adapt them for future years. So one thing that I saw, not necessarily in Worlds, but at District Champs, was the team used. So you could also climb the tower if you had captured at the end for extra points. And one team used two tape measures on each side to pull themselves up, and that was something that was really cool, and it held a 90-pound robot up. So it was something that we definitely wanted to look to do in the future, because it was a really nice design for that, and tape measures are really useful, and they're pretty cheap to get, and we can adapt them. So that was something from the technical standpoint. Claire, you want to say something from the business?
On the business side, it really something that we noticed there, was that, like, the pits at the competition is a place where we spend a lot of time. It's a place where each team has a booth where they work on their robot, display things about their team. People can come and stop by and talk to you. Judges come by and stop and talk to you and look at your pit, look at what you have displayed. So at Worlds, it was hard for us going from Boston to St. Louis to bring things that we would want to display in our pit. We didn't plan ahead a lot because we were only notified, like, I don't know, a week ahead. So it was hard to plan for that. But going forward, knowing that it's great if you have an elaborate pit with lots of information, we can think about, like, having the whole team, like, put something in their suitcase or in their carry-on. Like, it's really easy to put, like, some papers about the robot in your carry-on and just bring it so that we'll have a pit that really stands forward and shows everyone what our team is instead of just having a barren pit with the robots and tools.
Thank you.
Dr. Baxter.
Just two things. One thing is, you actually have done even more than you reported on. You came to the Reading Metco pool party, barbecue and pool party, which was during the summer, and really going out of your way to reach out to the community and bring kids and families together around your interests. So both thank you for that and kudos for that, because it makes a difference. And then I also just wanted to say that I'm so impressed by your professional presentation and your public speaking. Those are skills that are going to take you far in whatever realm you go on. And I know that, I know from personal experience, it's very difficult to come to a space like this that's televised, that's public, that's people come from all over, and I don't mean different towns, but, you know, from all different realms, and to speak about what you're doing. And you've done it so beautifully more than once now, and I know you're doing it also in other venues. And you've got outcomes that attest to that in terms of the machinery that you have and the money you've earned and the business, the awards you've put yourself out for. So just kudos for those skills that you've obviously dedicated yourself to learning and have successfully done. Thanks.
Great. Thanks again.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you,
everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That was great.
Going to do the superintendent's goals update. Before that, I wanted to know whether there was anything on the consent agenda that anyone would like removed.
No. Mr. Chair, move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Is there a second?
A second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 6-0. Dr. Daugherty, you, I get. So everyone has had this for a little while and had time to review it. So I think rather than walk through each thing, if anyone has any questions or about anything specific. John.
Sure. So I know we were supposed to probably do this a lot early. This is not really a mid-year anymore. And I know we're going to be talking probably in the next meeting or two about doing the summative evaluation. But I think I pretty much outlined in the slides and in the action planning process that you have in front of you where we are for each of the five goals. I also feel that a big difference between this year and in previous years is we've made a conscious effort to tie in school committee presentations to the goals this year. In the past, As you remember, we used to have a school come in and present, and it could be on a variety of things that that school was working on. This year, we decided to make it much more focused on the areas that we're working on in related to the five goals. And so there is one slide that I have. It's more towards the end that captures all of the school committee presentations that we've had this year and how they've been related to the goals. So you really have been seeing the progress through the presentations, which I think is a much more effective way of seeing the information. So I'll take specific questions if you want.
I was just wondering if you could just maybe put those two slides, if we could just.
You talking about that slide?
Yeah, and then next one.
So just, yeah, two slides starting from last year. All of the different presentations and the goals on the right-hand side. And then continuing into this year. This calendar year.
This
one's. And how it's connected to the different goals.
No, I think that was very good. I think I appreciate, you know, the presentation because it helps us for the next part of the process.
Mm-hmm. I do want to pass out a draft, and I do emphasize draft, of something that we're in the process of creating a dashboard of data on the different measures. And this is a work in progress, but I want you to see what we've been doing. It's a little bit outdated now because originally this was going to be ready for the early April meeting. And again, this is a draft. A lot of these charts you have seen in presentations. And we've been using our support from the School Transformation Grant, our data analyst, to help us with this. But these are a lot of the areas that we are looking at that are related to our goals. And what we're trying to do is two things. One is that we're going to have some common data points that all schools are going to be focused on. And a lot of that is what you see here. We're then going to have another set of data that's going to be specific towards one school in an area that they need to focus on. So as we move forward, and I'll just use for an example, and you know, if there's a high tardiness rate in one school compared to other schools, that's an area that they're going to be focusing on more, on what types of interventions need to be put in place to address the tardiness issue. I'm using that as an example. So we're going to be spending a lot of time over the next few months as schools are developing their school improvement plans. And principals are developing their goals for next year, looking at the school-specific data as well as more of the district-wide data to come up with those data points that each school is going to be working on.
And this dashboard will be on the district page? Or?
We're trying to figure out the best avenue to put it. Right now, don't forget, we're also in transition with our web pages, so we're trying to figure out where's the best place to put it.
Yes.
Thank you. So a question, and you completely anticipated it, a question I had tonight on the presentation was the common measures. How will we as a committee and how will the public get updated on, you know, it's good to see that there's progress towards tracking them, but I'm really interested in seeing the progress, and this is a real step in that direction, so I'm thrilled with that. Sort of a global comment, and it's really addressed to the committee and Dr. Doherty together because we do goal setting collaboratively all together. I would love to see, a lot of the goals are implementation goals. We're going to implement this, we're going to start this, we're going to do this, as opposed to we will see this outcome. And that outcome could be, as you said, a lower tardiness rate, or it could be fewer discipline referrals. The outcome could be any one of a variety of things. It could be test scores on internal common measures, not statewide test scores, but tests that our teachers have developed. I mean, it could be a performance. It could be any one of a number of things. But I'd like to see us, and I feel like we're on the path, but I'd like to see us continue to move to where the superintendent's goals are really student outcome driven and not so much input driven, if that makes sense.
It does. Yeah. And I think early on in any change process, it's going to be more that it's going to be more task driven. And then as things are being implemented, you're going to see more outcomes.
Yeah. And I think this is sort of
that's what I'm
beginning
hoping.
Of seeing that.
Right.
So I'm pleased to see that.
No, she took the words right out of my mouth. So nicely done.
What else?
Thank you.
So with the budget presentation, thinking maybe we should do the FY16 clean. Or clean up and then.
Why don't we? Yes.
Did you want to? Martha's not here.
Yes. So there are two things the committee needs to vote on tonight as a result of town meeting. One is to accept the additional funding of $150,000 in this year's budget, which town meeting supported for the science, the first phase of the science implementation of the curriculum materials. At our next meeting on the 23rd, Mr. Martin will be doing a presentation on that piece. And we're right on target to be able to move forward with that for next year. So that's the first, that's one piece. The second piece is the budget that you originally approved for FY17 had the $150,000 in it. Now you need to re-vote with the $150,000 out. So the motion that's going to be made tonight will see a change in the number for regular day and the total number, which is it was in the $150,000 was in regular day, and then your total number, both of those will be $150,000 less.
Yes, absolutely. Mr. Chair, move to approve the FY16 town meeting amended budget with the addition of $150,000.
Second. Any discussion or questions?
Can I just make one other point for the public who's watching this, is that, and this was made clear at town meeting, there was no free cash used in the FY16 budget to fund this $150,000. This came from transfers of different accounts, within the town budget to fund this additional $150,000 through savings and things like snow and ice and things like that. But there was no free cash used.
Thank you for pointing that out. Yes.
And just since we're clarifying for the public, it probably bears mentioning those watching town meeting know, but this is the first of a three-year installment.
Correct.
So the plan is another $300,000 on top of this $150,000 for a full implementation over a three-year period of the science curriculum. So this is the first of a three-year plan. Just wanted to say that.
All those in favor of the motion? 6-0.
Yes, Mr. Chair, move to approve the FY2017 town meeting amended budget in the total amount of $40,697,666, consisting of the following cost center amounts. Administration, $963,694. Regular day, $24,710,947. Special education, $12,223,473. Other, $1,608,042, and school facilities, $1,191,510.
Is there a second?
Second.
So that's, as Dr. Daugherty said, just taking the $150,000 out of there that was originally in there. Any other discussion? All those in favor of the motion? 6-0. Thank you. Okay, now we have the budget preparation, budget up for FY18.
So, I wanna do a couple of things in this presentation. One is I feel It's important for the community for us to delve a little bit deeper into the FY17 part of the budget. To answer some questions that still may be out there, I know some comments and questions were brought up at town meeting that I feel it's important that we address, because I know that this is going to be an education process over the next several months as we lead to an override ballot question. But I also want to talk a little bit about FY18 and some of the things that through the last year we have heard from the community as well. So we want to kind of do both tonight so that we can continue to educate the community. So first I want to take a look at FY. And some of these slides you've seen before. So so this, basically, the budget that we presented to town meeting, a budget that we presented to the community, is an aligned budget with our goals. We just talked a little bit about the goals in the previous agenda item. It is representing a 3.1% increase. It is a reduced from a level service budget. We did have to make reductions in $658,000, which resulted in a reduction of 7.3 staff, 6.3 of those teachers. A couple of things it does do is it restores our per pupil budget that, and you're going to see some charts on this that we've actually had to do that twice over the last few fiscal years. And it does include a 0.5 teacher at Barrows because we have that bubble going through in grade one and a social worker at Killam. The drivers, as we've talked about before, really, it is focused on the contractual agreements, both for union and for non-union salary. Currently, in the third year of the collective bargaining agreement next year, essentially the cost of living adjustment for all bargaining units is 2.5%. We also budgeted 2.5% for all non-union. So the 2.5% that was in the budget that was passed by town meeting really is that's reflective of all employees, a 2.5% increase. That's also very consistent with similar COLAs that was on the town side. We also had some drivers with special education transportation and also in regular education transportation. So that did also was a budget driver. That's a contractual increase. We were going out to bid for both of those. And those came in around 4 or 5% increase for both. I also want to, over the last couple of years, we've done a lot of restructuring and collaboration and cost savings to get to the budgets that we have had. So when we're faced with a situation that we have a deficit or a projected deficit because our level service isn't matching the funding revenue that's available, we've tried to do some things that have either restructured existing positions or services or has allowed us to do some consolidation, which has saved us some things. So some of these things we've done with the town. Facilities is an example of that. In November, we made that switch to a core facilities so that all of the facility piece is now in a shared budget cost center, shall we say. We're now really only the custodial for the schools is under the school department budget, and for the town custodian is under the town budget. We do share some HR services with the town. We also are going to be sharing procurement with the town, so the town will now do all of the procurement. In the past, that was done separately, but now with the shift of facilities over to a core and a restructuring of position on the town side, procurement is now going to be done by the town for everything, not just for facilities.
Yeah, I know in some areas it may be difficult, but not tonight, obviously, but as we move down the road, we may maybe get with the town manager and just try and quantify, the save, because we call it savings, but we really don't have it. We don't put a number to
yep.
it. Yes.
Dr. Daugherty, who actually handled procurement Whose responsibility was it?
The Director of Finance.
Okay.
I'm sorry,
I didn't know you. I'm sorry.
Will we still be using the same collaboratives? I know that our previous assistant superintendent had set up some ways to get the best price on resources.
Anything that's on the state bid list, that would not be, procurement is when you have to go out to bid for something.
Oh, all right,
but
sorry.
But we still will use the same state bid list that we've always used.
Okay, thank you.
There have been on several occasions over the last few years where we have taken existing paraeducator positions, both regular education and special education, and restructured them to teachers where we have found a need. So we have done that on several occasions. Under professional development, as you know, last year, we took over $150,000 in professional development funds and restructured it to two coaches that we felt would give us a much more important role in helping teachers in the classroom. We've also done savings through our school transformation grant, through our per pupil building budgets over the years, through restructuring of staff for special education team chairs and consulting services. And most recently, as I mentioned at a previous meeting, we are making a switch to a more integrated student information management system that's going to be a cost neutral or actually less in the budget. I want to talk a little bit about the POST program, and I know Carolyn can probably add to that as well. A couple of years ago, we were spending well over $200,000 to EMARC for providing services for our POST high school students. We made the decision at that time and to give our students what we felt was a much more richer program, to go to a program and collaborate with Wakefield, which is ending its first year and has been very successful. That has been a budget neutral decision that has not cost us any more funding. You know, in the future, we're going to continue to work with the town of Wakefield. Actually, the Board of Selectmen are the ones that approve the inter-town collaborative agreement. But this is not a program that has cost money. It is actually a program that's been budget neutral. So I want to make sure, and I don't know, Carolyn, if you want to add anything to the
Well,
the
they've
post.
Moved to their new location, and I think our students are really thriving with the opportunities to be in the community, to meet different peers, which is something that really this collaboration has allowed us to develop new peer relationships beyond those students they know here in Reading, which I think has been fantastic. And they've had some really different intern opportunities as well as community-based trips. So a lot of our students are now learning how to use public transportation, use the Charlie card, replenish that. They go to the YMCA. So there's a lot more opportunities for them than what we were providing here. And I think we have a better sense of what's happening in terms of the monitoring. Instead of contracting with EMARC, we're in close collaboration with the POST program. The team chair at the high school meets with the staff at the POST program every week to check in on our students, to monitor, to visit the program. So we're really able to see what they're doing and how they're progressing, which has been fantastic.
If we were to go out and say that the POST program dissolved tomorrow and we had to send these students to out of district, which we would have to still provide those services till they're 22, you're talking with transportation, no, excluding transportation, $60,000 to $70,000 a student. So this clearly is an example of a program that through collaboration with another community is working and is working in the best interest of our students.
So I have my question was, and you partly answered it. We've taken it in-house effectively. I mean, we've previously used EMARC, now we're brought it in-house, and I know it's cost neutral now. Do we see any down the road where it can be cheaper to do it in-house as opposed to I know it's cost neutral now. Do we see any savings in the future?
I think it's going to vary dependent on the students. We have some students in out-of-district placements that we've been talking about the program with. The other piece is because of our partnership, Lynn O'Neill from Wakefield and I have been able to kind of sell the program to other districts. So we're hoping to get some other districts who might be interested in tuitioning students in, which would then decrease the cost for both communities. So we've been talking at our collaborative meetings with other directors about what we're doing in our program, and we've had some interest in people coming to visit, so we're hoping that will help it as well.
Oh, that's good feedback. I mean, I think we should be, you know, real bullish on that and working that.
And the market.
You know, and I continuing on with the special education piece, you know, we've done a lot of work over the last several years to develop in-district programs, which has saved us money in the long run, but is also what's better for students. And that has minimize the increases in out-of-district tuition costs. Our special education budget is going up higher than the rest of the budget, but it would be going up a lot more, and I think that's an important thing to understand, if we weren't creating and strengthening these in-district programs. So we've also done lots of cost savings over the last several years with the town on performance contracting, the energy savings from that. And classroom space is a whole nother piece that we've been extremely creative with. I'll give you an example that next year we have to do some creative use of space at Birch Meadow because our DLC program is now expanding where we have to use a second classroom. So we've had to move an existing space that is now going to become part of the library so that we can move some other programs around to make that happen. And we're doing that every year. I don't know how many walkthroughs that Carolyn has gone on this year with the building principal and Joe Huggins to figure out how can we use the space more efficiently and effectively to service the students. So space continues to be a concern, but we're doing everything we can to make sure that
using the space that's available. And John, just speak to that the students we are able to service in our in-district programs are students who have complex needs. So some of them are medical, some of them are other physical challenges. So when we're looking at those space issues, there's a lot of factors that go into how we can accommodate those students within our buildings. It's not just, oh, we'll just create a space. We have to look at air conditioning. We need to look at where the restroom facilities are located in relation to the classroom, navigating the hallways, the stairwells, all of that. So there's a lot that goes into it. It's not just finding this one space. So just keep that in mind as we develop strong programs in district that can service more complex students. We have to have the space to be able to meet their needs, which those needs may be different than other students.
So this slide I showed at town meeting, but I think it's important, again, for the community to see. The top number is the number that was voted on, and that's the operating budget. But there are a lot of other pieces that go to fund our school department budget. You have all of the revolving fund offsets, kindergarten tuition, the athletic user fee, you can see them all there. All of those help contribute to using funds that are earmarked for those areas that you see in those revolving funds, which allows us to use our operating funds on other areas. And I think that's a very important point. We also received the circuit breaker piece, which is actually a grant that helps offset the costs of students that cost more than, I believe it's $40,000 a year. And some years we get 75% reimbursement, other years it's less. It's really what the state funding is available for that grant. So we do get some relief in that area. We also have some grant awards. Most of them are state awards. Or federal, and you can see we have the IDA grant, which is a federal grant for special education, METCO, which is to help support the METCO program, which is for tuition and staffing and for the METCO director, the school transformation grant, which has helped supported us in a variety of ways, as I've talked to you before. We also have some smaller grants like Title I and Title II, the early childhood grant to help support RISE, the academic support grant, and special education PD grant. Those are grants to either support students or to support Professional Development. The bulk of that award is either the IDA grant or the School Transformation Grant. Those are the big numbers in that 1.8. So it's more than the 40 million. It's other area, other revenue streams as well that help support what we allow to do. And then at the bottom, the donations that are accepted by the school committee, which helps support a lot of things outside of the school budget or those other areas, and certainly PTO and volunteer help. So it really is a complete package. The budget that...
Hold it.
Yep.
Gary, too, but I just wanted to say, so that doesn't, those school committee accepted donations, do they include, doesn't include like the, it cost $50,000 to get the science team to...
No, it doesn't include that.
Right, or the Robo Rockets to St. Louis.
No.
So, like, to really do all of the things that that our students do, it's still, if that's a half a million, then those kinds of things are easily a half a million a year, I bet, in terms of the different types of teams to go to competitions.
And Dr. Jarry, I was wondering if you've heard anything from DESE relative to the potential of, I think I mentioned to you a while back that the federal government is going to disperse $5.2 billion to cities, to states, and then some of that will be obviously distributed probably through
the Title IV grants you're talking
Title
about.
Title IV, but also 2A, too, I think.
Yeah, we have received nothing from DESE at this point. I've done some of my own research, but that's been more of the federal information. But we've received nothing from DESE at this point.
Okay.
In terms of the budget, you could see the budget that was approved, which is the $40,697,000. But really, if we were to move everything forward at the contractual increases and other increases that I mentioned earlier, it really would have been a $41,355,000 budget. So we needed to make some reductions. And over the last 3 years, we've actually had to make reductions because we've been in a position that our level service budget has not equaled the revenue that's been available. So you could see in this chart here that we've had to make a combination of personnel reductions and non-personnel reductions over the last three fiscal years. In previous budget presentations, I actually showed you a spreadsheet line by line of the different areas that we had to reduce. I want to talk a little bit about per pupil because there always seems to be a lot of confusion about per pupil. The formula to calculate per pupil is the same in every community. It's based on the end of the year report that every community is required to submit at the end of the fiscal year. Unfortunately, not every community submits it on time. So right now, we're still looking at FY14 numbers because FY15 still is not complete and is being audited right now by DOR for all the communities. But as you can see in this chart, the gap has grown wider and wider from FY06 to FY14. So one of the questions that comes up, well, what happens if you take this out of the per pupil? What happens if you take that out of the per pupil? So we did some further digging and drilling into the analysis. Some of it we actually had to ask the department for help, the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education, because we didn't even have the capability of drilling down. They had to do it for us. So I'm focusing on the 30 comparable communities that both town and schools has been looking at. So when you take a look at the overall per pupil ranking, we're 29th out of 30 comparable communities. If you looked at benefits, because that's something that came up, we're 28th out of 30th. Bus transportation, which we don't have a lot of, we would be ranked 25 out of 30 if you take the bus transportation out of the mix. District leadership and administration, because this is the central office piece, and you know we've heard in the past about, I mean, what would happen if we cut an administrator or something like that? We're actually 22nd out of 30 in district administration. And then going one step further, what happens if we, where are we ranked with curriculum leadership and building leadership, which is something that we don't have a significant amount of in the district. We're 26 out of 30th. So, and here's the back information. So here's our total per pupil expenditure. You can see Reading is ranked 29th. There are the communities that are up above us. Our per pupil is 11,807. I think it's 807. And you can see where we fall on that compared to the other comparable communities. So that's total per pupil expenditure. When you remove the benefits piece, our ranking is 28 out of 30. So that's the final column. The second column, second to last column on the right is what our per pupil would be if we took out the benefits piece. The per pupil expenditure, so it's about $1,733 is that piece of the per pupil expenditure for benefits.
But that's actually a good thing because it means we're not spending as much as other communities on benefits.
It means two things. It means that, but it also means that the employees are paying a little bit more, which is the case in other communities.
Question. So when we talk benefits, are we talking health insurance? Or
health insurance is part of that. It's other things too, but health insurance is the bulk of it.
That really doesn't come out of our budget though, right? Health insurance?
No, but it is calculated as part of the per pupil.
Does it come out of some school district's budget, or is it most?
It does vary from district to district, but it is calculated as part of the per pupil.
Yeah. So that's a pretty accurate rating when you take that out, because now it's apples to apples.
Right, exactly.
And what can I ask one more question?
Sure.
What is the percentage that our teachers and employees are paying for their health insurance? Do you know off the top of your head?
29%.
They pay 29%.
Yep. And the town picks up 71%.
Okay. And you say that's high.
Most communities are paying 75-80% or more.
It's high for the public sector.
Yeah, the public.
It's very typical if you were comparing it to the private sector.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Did you have a?
No.
Transportation, you can see that we spend, it looks like, $255 mm-hmm. per pupil of transportation. When you take that out, our ranking moves up to 25th. If you take transportation and benefits out, we're at 26th. And then administration, which is the district administration piece, we're ranked 22nd out of 30th. It says 29, should be 30. And then the district and school instructional leadership, which is a separate group. So this would be anyone that has some sort of curriculum leadership in the district that's not district-wide. So it would be department heads, curriculum coaches, things like that. We're 26th. So all the districts above that you see there, they have more of those positions, which is something that we've been talking about. Any questions on any of these numbers that I just presented?
Can you just state your name? I'm sorry.
My name is Samantha Kerr. I'm just wondering what the key criteria you use for selecting comparable communities.
These are communities that both the town and schools have used. It's based on form of government, the type of median house value, similar types of communities and residents in the suburbs. A percent of business, things like that.
There's been a lot of discussions, yeah. And this list has been changed and altered. And I mean, the superintendent and the town manager spent a lot of time, and it's not necessarily mean doesn't necessarily mean they have to be right in the Middlesex League. They're just, but I think that, you know, we've found that this is a probably the most accurate comparison we've come up with in over a lot of different iterations over the last few years.
Yes. If I could add to that, I agree completely with what Mr. Robinson just said. And something to me that's interesting about this list is the school committee made our own list
right.
a year or two years ago maybe, and we based it on DESE criteria, and it was a lot of the things that Dr. Dory, in the budget book, it actually lists out what the criteria were. So it was, yeah, population and whatnot. So these are the criteria, and we looked at the list, yeah, that made sense. On the other side, on the town side, they were doing the same thing, and there was tremendous overlap. But they had a couple towns we didn't have. We had a couple towns they didn't have. And there was sort of a, you know, let's just put the lists together. So that gives it a little bit of validity, too, that two different groups looked at it and came up with very similar lists. And instead of continuing to use two separate lists, so let's just use one. So that helps. Is that accurate? I just want to make sure that was all. It's my impression of what happened.
That's a great question, though, because it's, you know, you could come up with as we have a bunch of different lists.
I have one more.
Yes.
Mr. Robinson. Something just to sort of keep in mind as we're looking at this list, this is 2014 data.
Yeah.
Just, I know we don't have access to more recent data, but it would be interesting to keep an eye on those groups down towards the bottom with us, what's going on in their communities. They're obviously struggling with some of the same stuff we are, and how are they dealing with it? Just something to kind of keep our ear to the ground on.
I want to talk a little bit about professional development because unfortunately the way DESE categorizes things is sometimes you need to drill down a little bit deeper to explain the story. These are the main categories for professional development that are in our budget. Tuition reimbursement is a contractual obligation that we have in, I believe, three of our five collective bargaining agreements. There are spending caps in each one of those, so can't go above a certain amount each year. What we have found over the last couple of years is we're actually reaching that cap for the teachers especially. So that item is a contractual obligation. Curriculum leader stipends, the jump there, as I explained to you in January when we were presenting this, is that we made the switch to virtual high school this year, and we decreased what was called Plato to provide more opportunities for students that wanted to take online courses, but also for students that were in transition back to school and needed to provide educational services for them, and then to do that we were trying to balance an agreement where when you have teachers teaching the courses with virtual high school, you get more slots available, so that's what that increase was. The mentor stipends went up, just the contractual increase, that the 2.5%. District-wide PD, I want you to notice in FY13 it was 174,000, and in FY17 it was 38,000, and that was because we shifted district-wide PD funds for the two instructional coaches. So there has been a shift in district-wide PD. The stipends, you can see that the conference workshops have gone down, and the materials and the expenses have also, even though it's a large percentage, it's less than a couple of thousand dollars. So professional development has not been a major budget increase. In fact, it's actually gone down over the last few years. And that's because we've done the restructuring that we felt was necessary to continue to find ways to improve the ways that we provided support to our teachers.
Yeah, Ms. Burrows.
Quick question on that. Those decreased lines, don't they also include substitute pay for teachers to attend professional development? Isn't that?
Oh, no, that's a separate. That would be separate.
Substitute pay for PD isn't in the PD.
Substitute, no. Oh,
okay.
No.
Thank you.
Doc.
I'm just wondering if I'm understanding correctly. The tuition reimbursement, if we've already reached a cap now in May, does that mean that teachers that take courses this summer when presumably they would have more time to do it would not get any reimbursement because we've already reached our cap?
I think the way to, the better way to answer the question is that once we reach the cap, and if teachers are taking courses beyond when we reach the cap, then they're no longer getting funding, correct?
New Year starts in July, though.
Yeah.
July.
So, all
right. No.
Not
no.
for this?
Teacher's contract goes August 31st
oh, yeah.
to September,
right.
September 1st,
oh.
August 31st.
September to August. Oh, wow. So if we're already there.
But our fiscal budget, though.
It's based on the teacher's contract, not the fiscal year.
Just a clarifying question on that. Teachers have to get pre-approved.
Yes, there's a whole process.
I just don't want anyone thinking that
no,
a teacher
a whole
is
process.
Taking before. Yeah, so before they take the course and pay the money, they see if the cap has been reached and they hear back. So it isn't like a teacher is taking a course and now finding
and
out it won't be. I just want to make it clear.
There's a whole pre-approval process,
yeah.
And then they certainly have to also turn in their grade before they can get the reimbursement.
Good. Thank you.
Yes.
So would that mean that someone that's planned to take a course this summer might have applied already and had that approved? I see a head nodding.
Potentially.
So
yeah.
It doesn't mean that if they plan ahead, then that would make it under the cap. Thank you.
What?
Yeah, I just, you know, this has been an item that I know when, for many years ago, it was much lower. It had been increased, and then, but the 98, you know, it's been at the 98 now since obviously this last contract, right? Or well, actually, the cap.
The 98 is three bargaining units.
But the cap has been there for a while. But
yes.
I do know that some number of years ago we did increase it to that, but it hasn't always been hit.
It's at 85 now, right?
It's 85, correct? For teachers.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
The comparable communities, I know I've heard in previous meetings that you know, we have one instructional coach, K-8 for literacy and one for math. And these comparable communities, when you go to meetings and speak with other superintendents, can you just kind of tell us how many literacy coaches and math coaches and science coaches do other communities have? Typically, like average?
Actually, it's both of us that have gone to meetings, and I know Craig has gone to several meetings too, where it's there are several coaches at each level in other communities that are providing support to teachers in the classroom on instructional strategies, curriculum coordination, pacing charts, all of those things. There's different levels of support.
Strategies and the Common Core standards that it would be beneficial for Reading to have more?
As we've been transitioning in all of our curriculum areas, including science, which, you know, we're just starting,
right.
it's definitely beneficial anytime you make a transition like this to have that type of expert support to support our teachers. Absolutely.
And just one clarifying question. When you say at the different levels, do you mean like they have people that work with elementary, people who work with middle school, and people who work with high school?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
And too, in many cases, too, it's a matter of curriculum coordinator positions. So it could be a director of mathematics, and a director of science, and a director, I mean, that's not every district, but in many cases, sometimes if I'm talking to other districts for information, I could be talking to the middle level STEM coordinator, or the whichever. So they actually have different layers of, yeah.
Just a comment from colleagues I know work in other districts. In particular, the coaches will work with new teachers to familiarize them with the curriculum. Again, as Dr. Daugherty said, instructional strategies. So it's very beneficial to them, in particular to them, I think. But on a different note, who's actually, because they spread out, Whose responsibility, I would imagine, it's your responsibility, Craig, to evaluate them, their performance?
For the coach positions that we have now?
Correct,
yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And how do you get input from that? I'm curious.
So
since there's so many different, you know.
From the building principals and also through my own observations and discussions, yeah.
Teachers aren't involved in it?
Not formally, no. I mean, I know the coaches are gathering their own input from the teachers, and we discussed that as well, but it's not really a formal part of the process. But that might be something that we're looking at.
Yeah, just so some sort of survey, see how it's being used.
Yep.
I have a question along those lines too, because they're covering K through 8. Do you feel that they're spending more time in the elementary schools? Are they really?
Oh, yeah.
Is there any benefit to the middle school?
Yeah. I mean, so they've had some discussions with the middle level, and we're looking at that even for some this summer and into the fall. But we knew going in that their primary focus for the first couple of years would be elementary. Yeah.
Yes.
One more question. So the new science curriculum, wouldn't it be, I mean, how's that going to roll out? Who's going to be the, Craig Martin's going to be the curriculum coach for that?
Well, one of the things that we've done, one of the things that we've done, as you know, is through the teacher leaders and the PLCs. So every one of those areas and each one of those teachers get a very small stipend, and they coordinate that work with the PLC groups. I mean, so that's sort of the way we've just found a way to distribute leadership the best that we can, so that there are, you know, so that, for instance, I can have meetings or conversations with, say I'm talking to the middle level, I can get just the curriculum leader teachers who are full-time teachers, but they're also coordinating some of the work that's being done with their colleagues in those different areas. I think that's been very, very helpful for us to often literally be on the same page as we go forward with this work, because they'll be working with colleagues. And as there are questions and things, because I can't be at every one of those groups, I'm getting the information from each one of those facilitators or coordinators.
And I'm not looking at this at a critical vantage point, but it's nothing better than to have an actual coach in the classroom working with a teacher. And, I wish I was here during the budget season, I probably would have mentioned that.
And one of the things that we're doing too, I mean, for instance, it's not as if, okay, we have literacy and math, and so whether it's science or social studies are just left out. I mean, we're very much so, those other areas are still in conversations that we're having with our coaches, with the literacy standards that go across the board, certainly have the math that comes up with the science. And so they're involved, but we're doing the best that we can with those two positions. And I still think that those two positions are evolving. I mean, we knew going into that the first year we're not going to get the same type of impact, but it was sort of a long-term investment that by the time the second year and third year, it really is sort of a cultural shift of not seeing PD, or professional development, as just an external sort of event, but embedded into the work that we're doing every month and every week within our own classrooms.
Ms. Webb?
So I just want to clarify. So a lot of these, conversations when you reach out to other districts, so because of sort of the distribution, the greater level of resources and distribution of the resources, you're not necessarily talking to the assistant superintendent for curriculum. You're talking to like a director of curriculum who's below the assistant superintendent, or to the, like you said, the STEM coordinators or the science director. Mm-hmm. And I think that, when Gary, you just referenced, if I had been here in the budget season, I think we were talking about that and understanding that, we need to put the science curriculum in, and we're going to have to do it with the resources that we have and figure out, again, how to sort of restructure and parse and put pieces together to do it. But I think, we couldn't delay another year. We didn't want to do that. And thankfully, the town has, found a way in the budget to support that. But I think the whole conversation just really, highlights that we don't really have all the resources that we need to fully leverage, where we could be with students in terms of curriculum development and instruction and connections. We don't have that. That's what, that's what part of it's about.
Yes.
Nancy Doctor, just to follow up on that. I'm a little confused because I thought when you presented the science curriculum to FinCom, someone specifically asked about coaching, and you said the coaching was included in the price.
No, the professional development is the training.
If you purchased a new program or resources, normally they include professional development from the publisher or vendor into their contract. But that's different than a longer term.
So this will be a different, so the coaching is not included in what was presented then to this, for the science curriculum that you're going to.
The question that was asked to us is their training with the curriculum materials. That was the question that was asked, and that's what we answered, yes. But the ongoing coaching support
is additional than what was presented. That's what I'm just clarifying.
Correct, right.
So it's really, there's an additional cost that has not been determined then. Am I clarifying that?
No, we're saying we're going to do it. He just explained that how we were going to approach it. We're going to approach it in a way that we use the teacher leaders and the PLCs.
Right. I mean, normally the PD that's associated, it's mm-hmm. usually very focused on a particular program or resource. Mm-hmm. For instance, how do you access it? Are there digital resources? And how? So it's very much about the particular resource or program that you purchased. Where I see the ongoing coaching having to do with larger practices, instructional methods, and so forth that goes on beyond the particular program. If that's, does that make sense?
Yeah, no, I mean, because if you're going to ask for the if you're going to ask for the program,
yeah.
I guess I was hoping that you asked for everything you wanted. And you're saying, yes, you did.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. For the resources part.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes.
But what I'm understanding is we asked for what we wanted, but there are other layers that would help us to implement it better. If there was another layer of administration supporting and more curriculum specialists or mm-hmm. Another, some more administrators, assistant principals in our schools dealing with the other things that also need to be done, that would be helpful. That would be more optimal. But can we do what we need to do with this, with what we have? We're making the best of it by finding a way to make it work.
What we are currently doing is not effective for science instruction and science curriculum for our students. I think that's the bottom line. So we need to improve that. And our teachers have put a lot of time in this year to look at materials that we feel are an improvement.
But even whether we're talking about science, math, writing, literacy, or whatever, I'm not sure that I would want long-term professional development that's coming solely from one particular vendor
right.
or product. Because again, they mm-hmm. sort of gear it to, I think that's
right.
really important when you say, okay, this is a resource that we're using. But overall, the overall practices, it's like, the, you know, the math practices or the science practices, there are larger instructional methods that beyond just a particular program. And sometimes there are things that a particular vendor just doesn't address. I don't think there's any one particular in any content area, one perfect program that sort of has that. The resources, you know, I always try to differentiate between the state framework, the standards, the curriculum, and the resources or program, that those are three distinctly different things that clearly overlap, but they're three separate areas, three different things.
Does that answer?
The last three line items are actually going to be a segue into the next couple of slides. So the last three line items actually are the building-based line items, which is the per pupil amount that each building gets. So what you see in the budget in some areas under regular day is a collection or a summary, a total, of all of the different schools that have put funds into certain line items through their per pupil. And it's shown as a total for the whole district. Those three are building-based line items. So eight buildings have put in a varying amount of funds, and some haven't put any in, for conference workshop, PD expenses for general ed, and professional development for materials. Those are not district funds. Those are building-based funds. This segues into the building per pupil allocation. As we're developing the budget, we use the October 1st enrollment from the previous year to determine an amount of funding that each building will get to develop their building-based budgets, which essentially it's the day-to-day operations of the school. It funds materials and supplies and some building-based professional development if they choose to, the copy machine, some technology, If they need a couple of desks or chairs, that comes out of this budget. And you could see that there are different things in that last bullet that are listed. And so what has happened over the last few years, the last few four fiscal years, in FY13, we were making some cuts to avoid cutting staff. We reduced the per pupil. We understood, again, that was a one-year cut because of the purchasing cycle that we're on. In FY14, we went back up to the per pupil that we had been using. Actually, we went up just a little bit, and then in FY15, actually, we went up to that, and then FY15, we made an adjustment, which you can see there. FY16, we had to make the reduction again, which is the 130 that you see, and the 150 at the high school. And then in FY17, we restored those reductions that we made in FY16. You could see in the chart on the right what that equates to over the 4 years. And it's based on the amount of students that are in the building and the per pupil amount that we're allocating for each student. So you can see in FY17, Barrows, the budget that Mrs. Leonard is putting together is $58,520, I believe that is. And that is to fund all of the things to run the building that was on the previous slide. So when there is a line item in the budget, the FY17 budget, for, say, materials and expenses, that's based on all 8 schools. And so each year, the building principal is going to change based on what they feel the needs of the building are. So that's why you see a lot of fluctuation in those areas. Any questions on that?
Yeah. So a ways back, different superintendent.
Yes.
There used to be a holdback.
We still do a holdback, yes. And we released it on April 1st. So it's a 30% holdback. And that's in case there's ever any catastrophic cuts at the state level, and we have that amount, and all departments do that. All departments, we hold back 30%. We released that around April 1st. We figure once the snow is clear, that's kind of safe for the last quarter of the year, and principals do a lot of their purchasing for the next fiscal year with that holdback amount. So they're purchasing all their math materials, all of their language arts materials, all of those things are coming out of that 30%. So they're purchasing ahead.
Essentially, it works out that it's 100%. It's just that there's 30% now.
Correct.
And then
so the first part of the fiscal year, they spend 70%. The last quarter of the fiscal year, they spend the remaining 30%.
Which isn't actually, I was thinking initially that it was probably there was better ways to do it, but I think going back in my own experience that generally if it was fiscal year, if we're going to make expenditures, if we're going to purchase equipment for the following school year, it was all pretty much decided by end of June.
Mm-hmm.
So it really doesn't change too much, I guess.
This is what
I just want to clarify that sort of last thing you said, so that you said so there can be fluctuations in these categories like the classroom furniture, fixtures, instructional software, cost of programs. So you see that fluctuate because it's based on what the building principal is deciding to do.
Correct.
With their allocation. So right, the $46,800 at Barrows gets divided up among those 6 or 7 different categories. Right, and it can be from year to year, it can just fluctuate depending
right.
upon, so if, one year you actually did buy the furniture and stuff, so that for an enrollment increase, you wouldn't need that, you're gonna see it go somewhere else. So those, okay.
They get a bottom line number. And
correct.
Right, but then that
and they submit they submit a budget to us as part of the budget process.
Right, but that
with
number,
that number.
In like instructional software, cost of programs and licenses, it's an overall district number, but it's built by very specific information from each of the separate buildings, and
right.
it's aggregated.
And they do spend all of their per pupils.
I bet they do. Leave nothing on the table.
Correct. Any questions on that? Because I know a lot of questions have come up in the past about different line items and why they fluctuate so much.
It definitely doesn't include tissues.
No. Oh, and here's the detail by DESI category, which I was just mentioning, and by school.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You could, you know, it's depending on the school, it changes in on where the needs are. So now I want to spend a little bit of time, and I did put a very detailed memo in your packet about the budget reduction. So town meeting has now approved the budget, and so we can go into a little bit more detail now of where the actual reductions are happening. So if you just let me go through them all, and then I'll take questions at the end of the conversation. So the two elementary positions that are being reduced are happening at Killam. Those are, all of this was based on, all of the reductions were based on class sizes and enrollments in course sections. So I want to say that up front. In grade 3 and grade 5 at Killam, we're going from 4 groups to 3 groups in both of those grades. And I'll pass out in a second the current enrollment and what that looks like. But the class sizes at Killam for those two grades will be at 25. In grade 5, there is one other school that is actually at 25 right now. In grade 3, there are varying class sizes across the five schools. 25 is the highest right now. At Parker, there is going to be a 0.5 reading specialist cut. The delivery of reading services, we actually were meeting today with Mr. Norton and Ms. Shanklin to talk a little bit about what that's going to look like next year. And so had some very good conversations about how reading services are going to be restructured and what that's going to look like. At Ray Memorial High School, we have several reductions going on. I should mention that 2.0 of the reductions is the elimination of the advisory program. So on several of these reductions, you're going to see elimination of advisory program. Each department taught one or two sections, sometimes more, of advisory. So we had to make those reductions in that department. So the 0.4 PE and wellness, essentially that is the reduction from the change in the department head's role. So there is no change in course offerings, but the change in the responsibility of the PE wellness department chair is going to be restructured. So that's the 0.4 PE wellness piece. We are also reducing a 0.4 business computer science. There is no change in course offerings. The high school technology integration specialist is now going to assume 2 classes in that department. I will also say we've now consolidated the business department with the math department. So all of the business courses, computer science, is now under the math department. And that's a change that's going to be happening next year. We are also reducing 0.4 Latin, which is, again, no reduction of actual courses, but reduction of sections. In all of these, you're going to see a reduction of sections, but not an elimination of any courses. Where we had class sizes that maybe were low, we consolidated 2 sections to make one section of a course. So in Latin, this was the case. We did have some sections that were low enrollment of a particular course. We consolidated them. So the class sizes are going to go up to 20 to 22 in some Latin classes.
Okay. I'm sorry, I was reading something. I know you didn't want us to ask questions. Why does it say elimination of advisory? Is that what's
unknown? Some of the section reductions includes the elimination of advisory.
Okay. Most of them, actually.
It's framed.
teachers were teaching those advisory sections. So by eliminating those, we have to reduce sections in that department.
I got it. Thanks.
Of personnel. In English, we also had an elimination of advisory. Again, no reduction in courses, but we do have reduction in some sections, resulting in class sizes to 20 to 23 in some English classes. Social studies, same thing. We're going to see some class sizes go up to 20 to 24 in some social studies classes. Science, very similar. We will see class sizes go 22 to 25 in some classes. We are making a reduction in 0.2 fine arts, visual arts. This is in the visual arts section. There will be some increased class sizes to 20 to 22. Math, same thing. Class sizes are going to go up to 23 to 25. There is a reduction in 0.2 speech and language. It is not going to result in a reduction in speech and language services because we had some transition services that were put in place as we were transitioning from Barrows to Birch Meadow. And then the high school library aid, we're actually eliminating that position. We do have a full-time library media specialist in the library. The result of this is that the library aid would not be able to provide after-school library hours, but the PTO has agreed to fund that after-school library time, which is consistent with other schools.
We'll just wait until the end of the presentation. Thanks.
I do want to say that Mr. Barker and I met with all of the high school staff and talked to each of them to let them know what was going on. We actually talked to them prior to April vacation in case they felt they needed, you know, to look for other job opportunities because they were getting reduced. Full-time staff were reduced to either 0.8 or 0.6. We did have some part-time staff that were reduced lower than that, but they were already part-time. With the two elementary teachers, they are going to be reassigned to other elementary schools. We had some retirements in other schools, so those two teachers have already been notified of their assignments for next year. And the 0.5 reading specialist, that position, the person actually resigned before the end of the year and went to another school district.
Ms. Lieberman, did you have a question?
Yeah, I did. The impact on the class sizes, on what class is that based? Because it goes in cycles, right? Some years there are more students, and wouldn't the
this
class size in theory get bigger?
This is based on next
or
year.
Or smaller.
This
right.
is based on
but,
next year.
But what if the year after it's a big class?
These are based on next year's course sections and course enrollment numbers.
Right, but like year after next year, maybe
I understand
class sizes could go up. Much.
Different budget year.
Yeah, this is the FY17 budget we're looking at right now. So
okay, right, but the idea is if you cut teachers, it's going to be hard to accommodate to try and get the personnel, the teaching staff back if the next class is larger.
I think
wait,
the rest of the
yeah. Am I misunderstanding something?
Well, I think the rest of the presentation speaks to the following year. The rest of John's presentation sort of speaks to the following year, but.
So, well, I'm sorry, what was the question? So the question?
I'm just very concerned about that impact, the overall impact of cutting teachers, just in general, because if you cut someone from 0.8 to 0.6, that's gonna lead to low morale, possibly resignations. And once they're gone, it's going to be hard to get them back, especially if it's not a full-time position. You're trying to hire for a 0.6 something.
Okay, so the budget has already been this budget has already been approved by a town meeting. What you're saying is the context of what this meeting's about. We're talking about what's happening now, and we're gonna, as Ms. Webb just said, we're gonna evolve into next steps for next year, and so we don't like it either, but it's clearly something that we're trying to address on a global basis going from a financial standpoint going forward, and so that we don't have to do this, or we can potentially restore some of the things we had to do, but that's going to require town-wide discussions regarding the budget, and that's this kind of this part of the presentation, I think, sets the baseline for that.
Right. I was just trying to figure out how you determine the class sizes.
John,
The class sizes were based on the enrollments that we have for all the core sections for next year. Mr. Barker's spent a significant amount of time with his department heads, and then I sat down with him and reviewed all the core sections, and based on that is where how we made our reductions. And we also made it very clear we were not eliminating courses, that we would reduce sections but not eliminate courses. We did not want to deny students of courses that already existed. I will tell you, Mrs. Lieberman, I totally agree with you. These were some of the most difficult conversations I've ever had to have as a superintendent. As you saw from previous slides, we don't have anything else left. We still have to run a school district. We still have 4,400 students we have to educate. So we don't have a lot of options left.
So, just 1 second. I just have a question on the. So in the discussions, the planning in doing this, because we're going to do it, it's for our next budget, how do we determine, I mean, is it, like you say, a social studies class is going to go, is that, do we decide it's got to be maybe a junior or senior class versus a freshman or sophomore? I'm just thinking of, you know, or do we look at which teachers are better at handling bigger classes? How are we going to determine that? I mean, do you follow
what
I'm... You mean
the assignment of teachers to the different sections?
Yeah, and the kids, too. I mean, I'm thinking that I'd rather that it's probably not good for anybody, but I think it's a senior's more mature than a sophomore or a freshman, and they may be able to handle being in a bigger class. Then I guess, are we having those discussions? Or are we just, how are they determining which?
The reductions were made to specific sections, again, based on size.
Okay.
And honestly, off the top of my head, I can't remember where all of the different sections were that were reduced. Teachers are assigned based on licensure, based on level of expertise in a course. I'm sure that there will be some shuffling of teachers because of these reductions to different areas that they may not have taught before, but are certainly qualified to teach in.
So I just have one other, and I know there's a lot of, how did, with the Parker Reading, I know that person was leaving.
They had already left.
But how do we come to the conclusion that we just let that go, and why is that being reduced and not somewhere else? a Coolidge or whatever.
Well, Parker had 1.5 reading specialists, and all the other schools in the district have one.
Okay. Thank you. I missed that one. Ms. Webb?
So I just had a question. So on the library not being closed during the day, is that, I mean, I assume, well, Sharon has to go to eat lunch, and you're saying so there's no staff, or does she also teach?
No, she does not. She does not teach. This is more if she's out.
Oh.
And we're not able to provide coverage. I think that was more the idea.
Okay. And
She also has a very strong student crew that I know is in there and very active in helping students during the day.
Which is good, but you still have to have a teacher
Correct.
In there first and foremost. So I just one more question. So, or just comment, and I understand the course selection. So I think the impact on teachers, and I understand, so we're not eliminating any classes, we're eliminating
courses. Yep.
We're eliminating sections, and the students will be more students in the class, but by eliminating sections, you eliminate options. And so I just want to highlight, I know we're going to talk going forward about, you know, wanting to be able to offer more options, more depth, and more breadth in a variety of areas, and just this is a difficult cut, and it doesn't help us be able to you know, serve more students. We know that. That's what this budget meant to us.
Right.
So, you know, hopefully as we move through the next steps, we get the community, we get the support that we need to make the school system what we really want it to be.
Dr.
I was just going to, it's been said now, it was joining with Mrs. Lieberman in that no one wants these cuts. We're just trying to make the best budget that we can to do the best we can for the students with what we have. And I don't think that it's optimal for anybody, and cutting people's FTEs is not optimal. And you're right, I think that it does impact morale. And that's why we need to look forward and try to figure out a solution as a town. Because this is not optimal, it's painful. And it has been painful the whole time. And I guess I say thank you to our administrators who have minimized some of the damage that we would otherwise be experiencing. It could be even worse, which isn't saying this is good.
Dr. Doherty, I just kind of want to understand all of the reductions, and basically the way this reads, even though we've made whatever the total is, we're not losing personnel. You've reassigned the two teachers from Killam, and then there's 0.4s and there's 0.6s, but these reductions have been communicated. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. All staff know.
Okay.
Yes.
So
who are, yes.
Do we know? Do we have a sense yet if we're going to be losing personnel because we're reducing some people's hours?
It's possible. It's possible.
But we don't know that yet.
It's possible.
Okay. All right. And then I did also just want to say on the library hours, that's the first time that I knew we were cutting the after school. It's the first time that I've seen that it's going to be closed during school.
If the library media specialist isn't there.
Right. So I get that. But would that be something that would be a substitute situation? Like if she was out sick for the day, we would bring in a substitute?
We would, yes.
Like
we would try to get a substitute.
Like teacher,
yeah.
Coverage.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
And then just the 0.4 PE wellness. 0.2, it's really only 0.2 because, if I'm not mistaken, I think we had this conversation, 0.2 was picked up by our CASA or?
No, you're thinking of the person that's getting reduced, it's a 0.2, but in dollars, it's still a 0.4.
Okay,
cut.
Yeah.
Can I just briefly say something in response to Julie Joyce's question about whether we know whether teachers are leaving? I did speak with Adam Bacher about it after the PTO meeting at RMHS, and he is actually expecting that there will be some resignation.
All right, that, yeah. Alex, did you?
I do want to say thank you also for listening to us, the students, especially about the whole Latin situation. I mean, I think this is one of the best options you could have come up with what you're given. So thank you for taking that all into consideration.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I want to talk a little bit about class sizes at the elementary for a second. Which is a little bit connected to our conversation, but continues to be a moving number. So some things I want to point out to you. Let's look at grade 3 and 5 first, because that's where the reductions were made. So you can see that the Killam, this is next year's projected enrollment. It's based on right now everything that we know at this moment of families that are moving in and have registered with the Reading Public Schools for next year, numbers of students that are coming back from private school that we're aware of and have notified us, and current kindergarten, incoming kindergarten. So all of it's everything that we know at this point. So looking at grades 3 and 5, you could see the 25 at Killam in grade 3. And we have class sizes ranging from Barrows at 1920 to 23, 24 at Wood End and things in between. So we have a lot of range there. Grade 5, it's a little bit closer together. You see the grade 5 at Killam, at 25, but Birch Meadow is at 24, 25 as well. Wood End are at 23s. So there is some closer in the range of the schools there. Kindergarten is interesting this year and continues to go back and forth. You could see that our number is low right now for kindergarten for next year, at 268. There's about 35 kids, I think it's 35, that have notified us that for a variety of reasons will not be in kindergarten in Reading next year. That number is pretty common. That's the number we're around that number every year. Some go to private kindergarten and come back. Some, the families are deciding to hold their child out for a year. Maybe they're a little bit too young, even though they did qualify chronologically. So there are about 30 students or so that could move into grade one a year from now, but right now will not be coming to Reading. Our half-day numbers, you could see, are low in some schools. Our percentage of students that are in full-day kindergarten as of today is 75%, which is very consistent with what we've seen the last couple of years. So 75% of our students are in full-day kindergarten for next year, as of this date. We currently are going to be doing integrated kindergarten next year at Birch Meadow and at Joshua Eaton.
So we're going to, I'm sorry, finish. I'm sorry, you mean that.
No, I'm sorry, go ahead.
So we already have a problem at Eaton and Wood End first grade next year if we're going by 18 to 22.
So, yes. I'm glad you brought that up. I'll get to that in a second, but thank you for bringing that up. Birch Meadow and Eaton, we have integrated kindergarten for next year, and that's a combination of high full-day numbers and low half-day numbers. I'm keeping a close eye on Wood End because it is at 48, and we have a half-day of 12 and a full-day of 36. So that may go to 2.5. Stay at 2.5, or it may go to 3. We're going to keep a close eye on that. Killam is going to have 2 half-day sessions right now as we speak. They're at 25, and they'll have 2 full-day sessions. And Barrows, you can see we truly had a bubble go through Barrows because now they're back down to lower numbers again. Looks like they're going to have 2.5 at Barrows next year. Now, to answer your question, Mr. Robinson, we are keeping a close eye on Eaton and at Wood End because we have needed less staffing in kindergarten. It is possible that we're going to reallocate that staff to grade one. We're not making that decision yet because we want to wait and see what happens. But it is possible, yes, that could happen.
The grade 5 class is, that's, looks like it's one of the larger ones going, not the largest.
Yes, 376, that is a big class. Yeah. The grade 5 class is a big class. So, unfortunately, we keep getting calls every day of people moving in. There's a lot of for sale signs still going on. So, this is a draft and will be until the first day of school. So, but I wanted you to see this is where we're at right now with an FY17 budget now approved and with the numbers you have in front of you.
Where is this in comparison to previous years as far as the kindergarten enrollment?
It's low.
Okay.
Lower. We're about 20, 30 students lower than normal.
Below the you said the 35. Is it about average?
No, I mean, this point by now, we would be close to 300.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So we're about 20 to 30 students lower than normal. Okay. So I'm going to continue on. So moving ahead now to FY18. So over the last year, we've received a lot of feedback about moving forward and the needs of the school district. We had staff forums a year ago, 13 different staff forums we had. We had the Josh Reaton Task Force that met. We did the communication audit where there were 11 focus groups as part of that audit. The Walker Report, which has provided us data and information. We've done some internal work with our district leadership team in our common measure and school improvement plans and our state assessments. So we've used a lot of information to look forward and look ahead and see where we feel we need to be and where we need to go. Mr. Robinson talked about in his remarks at town meeting several of the challenges that are facing our school district over the next few years. Retaining and attracting staff was right at the top. Making sure that we develop well-balanced and prepared students for college and career, which includes a variety of things. Implementing a new science curriculum, implementing health and wellness curriculum, restructuring our elementary, middle, and high school schedules, increasing AP and honors course offerings, and providing support for struggling students. We also want another challenge is that we need to support our teachers, administrators as we transition to more rigorous standards and curriculum, and we talked a little bit about that earlier this evening. Mm-hmm. Continuing to improve our special education services. And I want to talk a little about those two bullets, because if we're doing the first bullet, the second bullet is going to become a lot easier. Because what happens in the general education classroom, the strategies that are used, the interventions that are done by a classroom teachers, is actually going to have less of a burden on special education. The two have to run hand in hand and work together. So that's going to be extremely important to make sure that our teachers have the toolkit necessary to be able to do that, because that's going to lessen the impact on special education services. Space is going to be a challenge, and we talked a little bit about that earlier. And remaining competitive with area schools. Families are going to have more and more choices as where their children will be attending school. And we want to make sure that we are remaining as competitive as possible so that Reading becomes the school that, for a lot of other families, it's always been, that they're attending Reading Public Schools from the time they enter in kindergarten until they time and graduate in 12th grade. So those are all challenges that we're going to be facing. I want to give you a possible glimpse into FY18. So if you take the budget that was passed at town meeting, the estimated increase is around 1% right now. The town manager has talked about that in several of his presentations. The amount of increase would be $407,000. The estimated operating budget for FY18, essentially moving everything that we're doing now, same increases, everything we're moving forward, would be $43,138,000. The operating budget with the increase would be about $41 million. So you could see that we're looking at potentially around a $2 million shortfall. That's a back of the envelope, but it gives you a glimpse at what could happen in FY18 if an additional revenue source is not identified. So where do we want our school district to? Oh, I'm sorry.
So you said, I know this back of the envelope. So it would assume sort of the same level of money from the revolving accounts. Does that? Because I know you know where.
Yes.
On that.
Yes.
Okay. But again, that can't last. That can't continue.
Right.
Much beyond this year. Okay.
And the other thing, and the union president's here. That obviously will depend upon
collective bargaining
contract.
Absolutely.
Right.
So over the last year, we've asked a lot of people about the types of things that we would like to see in our school district. And so where do we want our school district to be in 4 years? 2020. In 2020, we would have hopefully have been at a point where There's been a ballot question, and that there's been an additional revenue stream identified, and that we're able to do some of the things that we feel we need to do. So some of these things, and all of these are aligned to the goals that we've been talking about over the last couple of years. We want to make sure that we have strong curricula practices, structures, and supports in place for all of our students. That everyone is getting a tier one level of supports, all students. That then there's another group of students that are getting a different level of support if they're struggling academically or socially, emotionally. And then from that group, there may even be a third tier of support based on how their needs are. Those are the things we're starting to put in place now with that framework of MTSS. We want to make sure that we're vertically aligned in all of our curriculum areas so that when a student goes from grade 3 to grade 4 or grade 5 to grade 6, grade 8 to grade 9, we have an aligned standards-based curriculum with common experiences. We want to take a look at our elementary schedule. We want to make sure that we have increased student learning opportunities in arts, sciences, and health. We want to make sure we have common planning time and that we have a smart board that doesn't keep doing this. For our grade level teachers, we want to take a look at our middle school schedule so that it has longer blocks of time and intervention blocks to support students, a health component, which we currently don't have, and a high school schedule as well that has built-in intervention time for students that may be struggling, taking a look at our graduation requirements, offering flexibility for our students to explore courses of interest. These are all things that we heard from the community, both parents and staff, of where we want to be in 2020. We want to make sure that we have an updated information management system that has easily navigable web pages, data access and communication, that we have a plan in place to start addressing the long-term needs of our district, including a renovation to Killam. Killam is really the only school that has not had major work done on it, and that at some point, we're going to have to address Killam's needs. And that may be the point where we also start addressing the space needs as well. A plan to address full-day kindergarten. Our percentages continue to go up at the number of families that want it. You can see that it's becoming more and more of a challenge to have this two-tier system of a full-day program and a half-day program in the same building. Special education programs to allow more flexibility to support individual needs of students in inclusionary settings. And then a couple of other things which I think are important, very important. One is to support our administration so that they can support our schools and our district, and having greater ability to retain and attract staff. That's really some key areas that we feel we need to be in 2020. So I want to take a little bit about what does this look like, looking at a 30,000-foot view, not getting too deep. But in terms of the elementary piece, most elementary schools in comparable communities have schools 5 full days a week. And the model that we have in place was put in place over 30 years ago as a way to provide adequate planning time for our elementary teachers, because we didn't have the staffing to be able to do it during the school day. In addition, when you take a look at schedules from different districts, our students do not have the same amount of art, music, physical education, library technology time as other districts. So the current schedule is designed for the planning time at the expense of providing these other supports for in classes in other areas. So what we would look at is having a 5-day model, 5 full days, which would allow for additional 120 minutes of learning per week for students. It would eliminate the Wednesday piece of the planning time piece. We would still have occasional half days like we do at the middle and high school level. But that 120 minutes would be additional art, music, physical education, and library time, physical education slash health and library time for students. And then teachers would also have the ability to have common planning time, which is not possible right now in a lot of our schools because we share art and music teachers. And you can't create common planning time if you don't have those teachers in the building. It also will allow more opportunities for intervention and enrichment. So students that may be struggling, there'll be blocks of time to be able to support those students. Students that maybe need more challenge and more enrichment, those blocks of times would be there for them as well. Having a 5 full-day schedule allows us to do more of those things. At the middle school level, one of the areas that of concern is that we really do not have a strong expanded health curriculum. We do have health lessons being taught in our physical education classes at various times during the year, but it is not a comprehensive health education program at the middle school level. We also want to take a look at the current schedule. We're having that conversation today. Is how can we create dedicated intervention and enrichment times for students in a middle school day? How can we have advisory at both middle schools and additional instructional time for some courses? So those are conversations that have started happening between the two middle schools, and I know will continue into next year.
So I just wanted the advisory that you talk about the middle schools, it is not the same model as the advisory that we are taking out of the high school. So I just
correct. Yes.
Right. It's a totally different model.
Correct. Model. Thank you. Yes.
And I just the additional instructional time for some courses, and I think obviously this is the 40,000 foot level. So looking at what those being able to look at what those sort of key strands and skills are, and where in the past I think sometimes there are experiences that our students only get as part of an extracurricular or a club, but they're really important to be part of all students' experiences. And that's something that I think we haven't been able to move forward on for except in some ways with the REF grants. There's been some progress, but not such that it becomes more fully embedded in the curriculum. So I think, I'm sure that's part of maybe I would hope that last bullet.
So on the, I'm sorry, were you done?
No, I'm done.
If you just flip back to the elementary, easier to say, we can do these things because we're going to have the kids in the classroom another afternoon that they're not in there now because if you go back to the middle school, we're not making the day any longer. So
no.
Something's got to go if we're going to add more time for some court. I mean, what's the point? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, I do see what you're saying. The middle school schedule is a little bit more of a puzzle. but what you want to do is you want to take a look at the different blocks of time and how you can use them differently than they're being used now. So it's a budget neutral. It's not an additional cost. It's a budget neutral.
Yeah.
Just a quick thing on the middle school time. The advisory at Coolidge. Coolidge doesn't have passing time in between classes. Parker has 3 minutes in between each class. So if you... that's like 18 minutes a day that that Parker could steal or could find if they just took away the bell system and just had no passing time the way Coolidge does. So the small, there's a lot of differences between the two middle schools that could be, found.
Gary.
I just want to go back to the elementary one just for clarity's sake, having been a teacher when we actually reduce the Wednesday afternoons. the minutes that were, that are missing now, 120, were added on Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, so the kids, the students started earlier and left a little bit later, just so people at home don't think that the teachers were teaching less, it was actually the same, just a good way to provide the common planning time. And then middle school semester, two semesters or trimesters?
Quarters.
Quarters. And consistent, so do they change that much? Like if you're in quarter one, do you have the same course in quarter three?
Some of the electives are semester based, but that's about it. The courses are, most of the courses are year long.
I'm just aware of a lot of middle schools that have, I'm not sure why, but they have trimesters.
They have trimesters, yeah.
That's been discussed at the middle level too.
Yeah.
I mean, there's, I think many people might even be interested in that, but it's just pros and cons of working out, especially with the semester courses, how you do that, how you report out grades for a semester course if you're in trimester. It's doable, it's just a different structure.
I just want to say on this, sort of to your point, Chuck, about, we need the kids, bringing the kids into the school for that Wednesday afternoon is probably the easier part, most likely. But the resources that you need to bring in, obviously, in order to enable that to happen is the expensive part of the problem.
On the elementary, the side that you were just on, where an idea to bring back to the principals to maybe consider is increased art, music, PE, health time. I've certainly heard appetite in the community for recess, more recess for elementary students. So just as you're looking at what to do with that 120 minutes, if there were opportunities and if it were wise to give kids an extra 10 or 15 minute recesses a day, it would be interesting to track the impact on academic achievement, but there's more time, but then there's also getting more out of the time, and there's some pretty significant evidence that when kids run around for 10 or 15 minutes, they come back and do 20 minutes of math. They do better quality 20 minutes of math than if you make them sit for 2 hours.
Right.
So just something that I
They've already actually started having that discussion.
Wonderful. I'd love to see recess added to the list of things to increase on that slide. Thanks.
Just one more comment to that is that there's also a lot of ways to integrate movement during the course of the day when you're teaching.
Yeah, we heard
so
about that.
So wouldn't necessarily affect recess time, but you know, there's training obviously that needs to happen to do that, but there's a lot of evidence that supports that as well.
Coaching on instructional practices.
And then the high school piece, and then it's been a lot of discussion about the high school schedule. It's been an ongoing discussion right now, and I know that Mr. Barker has a few groups talking about it. But again, similar pattern. Right now, we have a 7-day schedule, 6 periods a day. You skip a period, skip a course each day. What we're looking at the high school level is, again, opportunities where you have time for interventions, time for makeup, activities, enrichment, improving the grade 9 transition, changing the graduation requirements so that you have more flexibility for students to have choices in going different areas. So everyone has a base of courses as part of their graduation requirements, and then if you want to pursue a strand in, say, engineering and the sciences, you have the ability to do that, or global studies, or business and technology, or whatever you know types of strands we would have available. So a lot of that is still under discussion. But we also want to expand opportunities for senior internships and also improve the community service opportunities. So there's a lot of discussion still going on in this, but this is something that looking forward to 2020 is an area that we want to improve upon.
John, to put anyone on the spot, but I've been hearing this is still under discussion for a while now. Is there a goal, a date set as to when we're gonna start putting something in place?
2018. Okay. I know they may be making some minor changes next year, but I know they want to make more changes for 2018.
Yes.
And so you would anticipate the schedule, the primarily, the big piece of this, I think, is the scheduling, as well as
Yeah.
The certificate. So you're saying that that would be something that would be detailed out next year?
Yes.
During next
yes.
year?
Yes, yes.
To be implemented
in
for 2018. The 2018 school year. Can I just ask? So the global studies, business and technology. So I guess you're combining the business, math, and computer science.
Well, business and computer science were together, but
together
now
anyway,
they're going under the math
department.
So
right,
the math department now will have all
eliminated
three
a chair. Did we eliminate a department chair to do that, or was they were or it wasn't really structured that way anyway?
We did have a business chair a year ago. We did not have a business chair this year.
So I guess as I, you know, we look at that and we look at, we're talking about sort of more programs and more breadth on course offerings, and but in this consolidation, I guess I just want to make sure that one of those, whether it's sort of the computer science or the business, doesn't become like subordinate to the math and not get the attention. So I think we need to, as this moves forward, you know, make sure that there's sort of the proper balance, and that you know, all aspects where you have sort of a combined department like that, that you make sure that all strands are sort of getting the right attention, which is where some of the resources we were talking about earlier would really help to support, you know, to support that and support the district. So just
yeah, I mean, this needs all hands on deck, and you know, whatever we can do to, you know, I mean,
accelerate.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, that's why we're presenting this tonight.
Can I just ask one other?
Yes.
John. So I know it's not explicit in here, but actually, it does say from FY17, let's see, there were no cuts in guidance and special education. Caseload. So there's nothing explicit in here necessarily about guidance, but I just want to say, you know, how important I think that role is. With the, you know, social emotional needs of students, the sort of the college process and support that students need, there's a lot to be done there, and you know, perhaps that's something that, as you have sort of a block for interventions or enrichment or something, that may provide an opportunity to better connect those resources to students.
Mm-hmm.
But I just want to say, I think that's an area that we need to really keep our eyes on. So to Chuck's point about sort of all hands on deck in terms of really ferreting this out, I think that's an area that needs, we need to make sure we're not cutting short because the demands are increasing.
But they have initiated a new approach too, right? Developmental guidance as opposed to the traditional one was in the past. So it's a lot more communication going on with the students and the guidance department.
Right. I just want to say, obviously, Chuck and I have had some seniors this year, and I think perhaps there might have been some thought process to think you could perhaps trim back a little on some college things. And I'm not saying not this year at all, but just sort of how do we do all this? And we're always being creative and thinking, is there something that we don't have to do so we can focus, say, on the developmental guidance? And I think the answer to the question is, no, there's nothing. You can't reduce the work and the support that you do for students from a guidance and college and career transition to put resources towards developmental guidance. This is a big shift for me, because if you had, you know, some years ago, I probably would have said we shouldn't be doing the developmental guidance. We need to be doing the college stuff. Like,
so
I wouldn't have.
Just to respond to that, I think developmental guidance and, you know, college readiness are helping them. It all pretty much goes together. It's not separated, if I'm not mistaken.
It's just a huge caseload. Our district, I'm sorry to take this off track, but here's an area where our guidance counselors in the guidance department do an enormous amount with and for our students around the college process. And so that's only going to become more demanding. That's incredibly clear. And so just think it's, you know, like many other things that we're talking about tonight, the resources that are required are, we have not been resourcing them adequately necessarily we've done the best we could, but they're only gonna increase as you go towards 2020.
And one last thing, I think you'd, in a developmental guidance program, you'd see the discussion start a lot earlier.
We're way down into the weeds now.
Sorry, sorry.
Yeah, we've landed from 30,000 feet. I mentioned earlier about additional curriculum, instructional leadership, and support. I showed you some financial data which shows that we are at the bottom of, you know, our comparable communities. There are school districts similar to Reading that have a lot of the positions that you see there. And really, they provide critical curriculum implementation and alignment and supports. And they also help building level administrators with supervision evaluation. I want to show you this chart, because this is an area I'm very concerned about with our building principals. And the amount of staff that they supervise and evaluate annually. This is an annual amount of supervision. Between professional staff, paraeducators, and secretaries, for those buildings at the elementary level where there's only one administrator, you're looking at 40, 50, 60 in some cases, staff that they are supervising and evaluating. At the middle school level, it's a little bit less because there are two administrators, and at the high school, there's really 3 1/4 mm-hmm. because the assistant superintendent for athletics is focused more on the supervision and evaluation of coaches, which isn't even included in these numbers. So I think it's important that, you know, we were talking earlier about, other sectors, the business sector, that these would not be acceptable numbers for supervision evaluation. What happens when you have these higher numbers, and our administrators are very hardworking, is that it turns into more of a exercise in making sure you've done the summative and the formative instead of using the tool for growth and support, which is really what the process should be about, because of the high numbers.
Yeah.
Can I ask a question about that prior slide?
Yeah.
How much of this is driven by the sort of state-required evaluation system, and how much of it is our own desire to provide adequate supervision? My question is kind of around an unfunded mandate.
I don't think this is... We actually had the same evaluation system in place before the state.
Okay.
I mean, we had a very similar process.
Okay.
You know, you want to get into classrooms and you want to do observations, particularly of teachers in their first 3 years. You want to make sure that every teacher has a mid-year check-in of their goals, and then an end-of-the-year summative of those that are in the cycle that need to be evaluated.
So you don't feel any chance that the state might lessen or find ways that the burden could be a little bit less?
No, I don't think it's the state that's causing this. Okay. I really don't. Because the purpose of supervision of the system that we use is really for growth and development. I mean, we do have some reporting requirements we have to give to the state,
sure.
But we'd have to do that anyway.
So, go ahead.
No, I think, yeah, thank you. Think about it a little more.
I think the process.
Look at him, he's the chair.
I think the process is a sound one. It's a matter of how it gets done.
Right.
And to make sure it really is about the substance and not compliance. I mean, you know, we're talking about some of the other positions. For instance, sometimes when I talk to other districts, if you had, for instance, a curriculum coordinator, those are administrative positions who might be doing observations, who might be working with principals about here's what it looks like in writing, here's what it looks like in science with the new standards, here are the conversations I'm having with teachers, so it's a collaborative thing. You're spreading that out more. And so there's various ways that I think different districts sort of attack that. And it usually has more to do with administrative resources. I mean, I don't think we'll ever get to the point where some districts are, but I think we're at an extreme sort of position.
Thanks.
I do want to just, I guess, agree with Dr. Daugherty, too, regarding the number of staff supervised and evaluated by the building administrators. Having done a lot of research on the new evaluation process, it wasn't designed to have this few evaluators. Mm-hmm. It was
right.
definitely designed. And even though Reading has been using a model very similar to this previously, you know, same thing applies. We really are, the goal of it, as you stated, I think, Dr. Daugherty, was professional, you know, improvement in their practice. And yeah, it just becomes a, you know, something like more of like a routine that they're going to accomplish, or a check the box of managed to get to 38 teachers or 18 teachers this year, but not necessarily provide them the type of feedback that they would benefit from.
Well, we're, I mean, that's, then we got to, as you, I think, Craig, we're just intimating on some other ideas, because we're not, if we do what we want to do, the staff isn't going to go away. So we got to figure out how to do a better job at it.
Well, and the measure, I think, is how do you do it in a way that actually has a positive impact on the student outcomes
yeah.
that you want? And that's the measure. How do you do that? Especially for something that is so time-consuming, you want to make sure that the time you're spending is having the output for students that you want, and that's a much more complex, you know, dialogue-rich process, as it should be, and I think that's the way it's designed to be, but it can be difficult.
Another area is, we've talked a lot about MTSS and making sure that we have the supports needed for those students that need more support beyond the tier one, that every type of support that everyone is getting. So there are definitely areas that we do not have those positions available right now, both social, emotional, and academic. And this is something that we are going to have to take a look at as well, if we want to help that percentage of students that are struggling. And then attracting and retaining staff. We're not competitive with comparable communities in terms of salary and benefits. And it's kind of a double edge, because in addition to that, because we don't have the additional administrative and clerical support, the workload is higher across the board for everybody. So we're not as competitive from a salary perspective and benefits perspective, and the workload piece is higher in some cases as well. So here's the number of teachers who have resigned from the district over the last 5 years. And they resigned for a variety of reasons. And we recently did do an exit series of exit surveys last year, and we'll do that again this year. These are teachers who have resigned, or not have retired, or have not been renewed, but just pure resignation. So teachers resign for compensation benefits, leaving the profession and maybe going to other areas, moving out of the area, or for family reasons. And it's pretty evenly spread across, but as you can see, the numbers have gone up a little bit over the last few years. There's a trend.
Or one of those could be also leaving for promotion. That's not on there.
Yes, that could be. Yes. Thank you.
Oh, leaving. Yeah.
I'll add that bullet. Yes.
Do we have an idea how that compares with comparable communities?
That data is not reported out by other communities.
And you were saying it is.
I don't even know if people
grades.
Collect that data. I know we do now, but.
And it's spread across grades?
I would say so, yes. So you've seen this slide before. We did an exit survey last year of teachers that had resigned. And this really, the workload piece, I think the green is too great. 47% said that, this is staff that were leaving. How would you describe your workload? 47% too great, and 42% varied, but usually manageable. So you could see that workload clearly is an issue with staff that are exiting the district.
I think those were reversed.
Yeah.
Just for people watching at home, 47% was varied, but usually
managed. Oh, is it? I'm sorry.
Yeah. Just to clarify.
The colors.
Yep.
Sorry.
42 is too varied.
As part of the exit survey, we asked about salaries and benefits, and you could see again that we have a wide variety of responses. It really is the health benefits and the base salary are the two areas that are usually most concerned.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's other areas that I know will need to be discussed. Full-day kindergarten, which I talked about earlier, additional special education staff, technology funding, and you mentioned earlier also director of technology, which we've discussed in the past. So those are all areas that are of need. But I think what I've presented to you this evening is more of a global view of some of the information that we have heard loud and clear over the last year, and the data shows, you know, where our needs are. You know, as we enter a very difficult budget year, but then transitioning to FY18, because that we're actually now discussing that budget. Very early, but those are the types of discussions I think we're going to be having over the next few months.
That's a good report. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I know people may want to say more about it, but I do want to be mindful of Alex. It's late. Did you want to give a report?
So this Thursday at 7 p.m. in the Performing Arts Center are the Scholastic Awards. So anybody is welcome to come. The Drama Club is also putting on an evening with Edgar Allan Poe on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at 7:30 on Friday and Saturday and 2 on Sunday.
He's actually coming.
And also there's a band concert next Wednesday at 7 p.m. in the Performing Arts Center and a chorus concert on the 26th, so it's the Thursday after that. At 7 p.m., and we hope that a lot of people will come. And lastly, the winter and spring bands and Color Guard recently had a banquet last Thursday for their seasons.
Saw that in the Chronicle.
Thank you.
I just want to say Alex, I think, does an excellent job presenting the many varied experiences that are occurring at Reading High School. So. Excellent job, Alex.
She'll be back next year.
I know. It's going to be better then. It's going to be hard, though, to improve.
Thank you, Alan. Did anyone have any other questions on Dr. Daugherty's report? I'm sorry to cut into that. I just wanted to, in case you have homework.
That's a good idea. Exams.
Good report. That's a good presentation. So moving on in the agenda, you want to talk about the Killam?
I can.
That's it, sir.
In your packet is a timeline for the Killam Elementary School search. As you know, Kathy Giles recently announced that she will not be continuing on after this year. I know that was a very sad announcement for a lot of the Killam community and the Reading community. I do want to thank Kathy for her years of service. She did a remarkable job both as a teacher at Barrows and as principal at Killam. So she will be sorely missed. We're in the process of starting a full search. We've posted the position. We've started to look for candidates to fill this role, and we are starting to put together a screening committee. So the screening committee, as you can see, is the search is very similar to some of the other administrative searches that we've done. We will be having a combination of stakeholders on it, administrators, staff member, teachers, and parents. The application process closes this Friday, the 16th. I'm sorry, Monday the 16th. Sorry, Monday the 16th. And the goal is to have a principal selected by the end of the school year. It is a little bit more aggressive than other searches, but we feel that we want to attempt to start a search process. If we feel that we do not have a strong pool of candidates, we will shift gears and we will go with an interim for next year.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, move to approve the Killam principal search timeline and process.
Second. Any other discussion? Those in favor? 6-0.
We didn't do reports.
Oh, reports.
I have one quick thing.
Yes.
Just, I think the 15th is the Hatchell, the jazz band at the Hatchell.
Yes, this Sunday, coming up.
Just wanted to mention.
I'm not sure of the time yet. I'll have to ask Mr. Mulligan.
I just wanted to mention that.
Just two quick things. The Coolidge Science Team yard sale was last Saturday, and it's an amazing example of the community and the science team, the kids, the adults, everybody working together for a common purpose. It just, you can feel it when you walk in the door. And it recycles things. One person's trash is another person's treasure. So I just wanted to comment on that, and good luck to the science team. And also, today I had the honor of seeing the preparation for a June 9th 8th grade concert at Parker. Jenny DiMuzio put in a lot of extra work to bring a Holocaust survivor, actually a legacy partner, to come talk to the kids to give depth to one of the songs that they're singing, which is composed of poetry that was left on the walls of the Terezin ghetto barracks. And it was just really amazing to watch the kids engaged in that kind of learning. And it was for a choral concert, so it just showed how the meaningful learning, cross-disciplinary learning happens, and the effort that some of our teachers put into making that happen, enabling that to happen.